back in verse 9, it says, "And they bury him in the border of his inheritance in Tanaphis, in the mount of Ephraim, on the north side of the hill Gesh. And also all that generation were gathered unto their fathers. And there arose another generation after them, which knew not the Lord, nor yet the works which he had done for Israel. And the children of Israel did evil in the sight of the Lord, and served Balaam. And they forsook the Lord God of their fathers, which brought them out of the land of Egypt, and followed other gods, the gods of the people that were round about them, and bowed themselves unto them, and provoked the Lord to anger." These verses make me think of where people will go when the prophet dies. When we look at the church today, with that which claims to be the church, we know that God has a church, but it's not necessarily the one that claims to be most prominently. I wonder what Sister White would say if she were alive today. 100 years may seem like a long time, but how soon that time of the pioneers came. After a short period of time, that God saw fit to found a government that shared many of the same fundamental principles, the same enemy that has sought to destroy God's church as it was being formed also sought to destroy the government that allowed it to grow in the midst of her liberty. Yes. Sure. Just give me a moment. These are out of order. As I said before, it was I had such a hard time. This morning I was trying to print my notes and the computer just started updating itself. Just give me a moment here. I probably should have numbered these. That's true. For those listening, Brother Max said that none of the pioneers would be able to join the church today. And unfortunately, you're seeing a lot of the sort of in-between generation being rejected now as well, with current events that are happening within the professed church today. In every country, every age, the priest has been hostile to liberty. He is always in alliance with the despot, abetting his abuses in return for protection to his own. It is error alone that needs the support of government. Truth can stand by itself. These were the words of founding Father Thomas Jefferson in a letter to Horatio Spotford in 1814. America was under attack from the Jesuits and from Britain and various powers. The founding fathers knew of the Jesuit attacks that were going on, and they spoke of them in their writings and letters to each other. And yet, William Miller had not even arrived on the scene yet. he was yet to discover the truth and proclaim it. But the birthplace of freedom was yet to bring forth a church full of truth and ready to bring forth a people that were worthy of the call to show forth the glory of Jesus. Today we see those who claim to be God's people fall after the very same enemy, however, and the representative of the enemy. I am, of course, speaking of the little foreign power. In Daniel chapter 7, if we'll turn there. Daniel chapter 7. It says in verse 7, "And after this I saw in the night visions, and behold, a fourth beast, dreadful and terrible, and strong exceedingly, and it had a great iron teeth, and it devoured and brake in pieces, and trampled the residue with the feet of it, and it was diverse from all the beasts that were before it, and it had 10 horns. I considered the horns, and behold, there came up among them another little horn, before whom there were 3 of the first horns plucked up by the roots. And behold, in this horn were eyes like the eyes of a man, and a mouth speaking great things." And in chapter 8, starting in verse 8, it says, "Therefore the he-goat waxed very great." This is speaking of the vision that represented King Alexander, the first king of Grecia. It says, "Therefore the he-goat waxed very great, and when he was strong, the great horn was broken, and for it came up 4 notable ones toward the 4 winds of heaven, and out of them came forth a little horn which waxed exceeding great towards the south and towards the east and towards the pleasant land. And it waxed great even to the host of heaven, and it cast down some of the host and of the stars to the ground and trampled upon them. Yea, he magnified himself to the prince of the host, and by him the daily was taken away, and the place of his sanctuary was cast down. And a host was given him against the daily by reason of transgression, and it cast down the truth to the ground, and it practiced and prospered." Do we know what power this is? Are we certain? Well, if we follow the fundamental teachings that we have been given over the years, then we do. If we pay attention to where God has led us through his signs and through the way he's led his people in the past. It could be none other than the papal power. The same power represented by the first beast of Revelation, chapter 13. You know that first beast, the one that was terrible, the one that the world followed after. But how strange and evil a power to follow after. Joining enemies. Enemy always starts with what? Compromise. In fact, the Bible tells us that deception is a result of love for unrighteousness. That there are two classes, the righteous and the unrighteous. If we'll turn to 2 Thessalonians. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 10. And it says, "And with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish, because they receive not the love of the truth, that they might be saved. And for this cause God shall send them strong delusion, that they should believe a lie, that they might be damned who believed not the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness. The Bible tells us that God sends a delusion, and not just a delusion, but a strong delusion, because they loved not the truth. Christ's character was exemplified in Abel, Noah, and Seth, and Enoch, in the lives of Abraham and Joseph, Moses, Joshua, Samuel, and David, and all the hosts of those recorded as having characters that God could approve. However, as examples, we are also given the character, the example of Cain, and all who form characters opposite to truth, fidelity, obedience, and righteousness. All had an opportunity to show themselves members of, members of the family of Cain, or members of the royal family. Purity and holiness come only through Christ. And the instruction given in the Old Testament scriptures is the verity of the word of Christ, as it is the instruction in the New Testament. How can we ignore one and accept the other? Christ was the very Redeemer. In the days of the Old Testament, he gave those of ancient Israel just as favorable an opportunity of working out their own salvation as he does for us today. Through faith, they could look forward to Jesus. Unfortunately, this became clouded. There are two groups, two characteristics: people who build themselves up and those who surrender themselves to Christ. In Great Controversy, page 88, it says, "Little by little, at first in stealth and silence, and then more openly as it increased in strength and gained control of the minds of men, the mystery of iniquity carried forward its deceptive and blasphemous work. Almost imperceptibly, the customs of heathenism found their way into the Christian church. The spirit of compromise and conformity was restrained for a time by the fierce persecutions which the church endured after paganism." Remember, it was Smyrna that remained pure in the book of Revelation, chapter 2. It's persecution that purifies the church. It will be persecution that will purify it again. But as persecution ceased and Christianity entered the courts and palaces of kings, she laid aside the humble simplicity of Christ and his apostles for the pomp and pride of pagan priests and rulers. And in place of the requirements of God, she substituted human theories and traditions. The nominal conversion of Constantine in the early part of the 4th century caused great rejoicing, and the world, cloaked in a form of righteousness, walked into the church. Now the work of corruption rapidly progressed. Paganism, while appearing to be vanquished, became the conqueror. Her spirit controlled the church. Her doctrines, ceremonies, and superstitions were incorporated into the faith and worship of the professed followers of Christ. This compromise between paganism and Christianity resulted in the development of the man of sin, foretold in prophecy, as opposing and exalting itself above God. That gigantic system of false religion is a masterpiece of Satan's power, a monument to his efforts to seat himself upon the throne to rule the earth according to his will. But according to Romans chapter 1, Even these pagans at one time understood the truth about God until they corrupted it in their minds. In Romans chapter 1 and verse 20, it reads, "For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse, because that they, when they knew God, glorified him not as God, neither were they thankful, but became vain in their imaginations. Their foolish heart was darkened. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools." It's amazing. I don't know how many people pay attention to academia. Some of these professors that speak, they seem very self-confident, but yet what they say makes no sense with reality. It's all theoretical, theory based upon theory. The theologians of today are laughingstock. There were actually some professors who were given, I think they were high school level tests from, I believe, the 1600s that the Christian schools used to give to their youth, and the university professors failed them miserably. It shows the dumbing down of our education system, because you can't fool people who are taught to learn the scriptures. That's what our education system was based on. The very first law passed for education involved a movement to educate in the Bible, as to not be deceived by witchcraft and by deception. I'm trying to remember the name of that bill right now, but it escapes me. But it says these people who thought themselves wise, they had an understanding of God, these people thousands of years ago, and they corrupted it. They made God into an image made like unto corruptible man. And yet we see that today in the schools that call themselves the schools of higher learning. I'm not talking about high schools, because they eradicated God from those public places, although they're not so public anymore. It says, "For God then also gave them up to uncleanness through the lusts of their own hearts, to dishonor their own bodies between themselves, who changed the truth of God into a lie, and worshipped and served the creature more than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen." According to these verses, they're without excuse, as well as God's professed church. It's just a different level of accountability. But what we're looking at is a very similar circumstance, that these people, like today in many churches, these people thousands of years ago were led into error, and it happened again and again. The Catholic Church was formed out of the same problematic tendencies that humans have. If we follow after our human nature, we will fall. Turning to the book of Revelation in chapters 2 and 3, Revelation chapters 2 and 3. And we can't read all of this, I'm sure, but it speaks of the messages to the churches. To the church of Ephesus, which starts in chapter 2 and verse 1. What was wrong with Ephesus?
She lost her first love.
That's right.
Left her grief behind.
She started loving something more than God. And one of the most common answers to this inquiry is that she loved companionship of others more than the companionship of God. That it became a social club, as it were.
Ecumenical.
Yes, ecumenical is Brother Max's Pergamos. Starting in verse 12, what was wrong with Pergamos?
They had been with the doctrine of Balaam and the Nicolaitans.
That's right. Thou hast them there that hold the doctrine of Balaam, who taught Balak to cast a stumbling block before the children of Israel, to eat things sacrificed unto idols, and to commit fornication. Thou also hast them there that hold the doctrine of the Nicolaitans, which thing I hate. What is that? What is the doctrine of the Nicolaitans? In Signs of the Times, January 2nd, 1912, it says, the doctrine is now largely taught that the gospel of Christ has made the law of God of no effect, that by believing we are released from the necessity of being doers of the word. But this is the doctrine of the Nicolaitans, which Christ so unsparingly condemned. All these same mistakes are happening today. The book of Revelation shows us a relationship between God, the worship of God, and what happens when we don't. We know that in the book of Revelation there is a situation that occurs to those who do not obey God. And what is that? Isn't it destruction? Isn't it eternal loss? That's right. There's so much to lose. There's a heaven to win and a hell to shun. And by hell I mean the grave and non-existence. Christ consented to die in the sinner's stead, that man by a life of obedience might escape the penalty of the law of God. His death did not make the law of God of none effect. It did not slay the law, lessen its claims, or detract from its sacred dignity. The death of Christ proclaimed the justice of his Father's law in punishing the transgressor, in that he consented to suffer the penalty of the law transgressed. And the death of Christ proclaimed the justice of his Father's law in punishing the transgressor, in that he consented to suffer the penalty of the law transgressed by himself, speaking of man, I think, in order to save the fallen man from its curse. The death of God's beloved Son on the cross shows the immutability of the law of God. It can't be moved. It can't be touched. We can only be substituted for. Christ died that we might have a chance. Not a fourth chance, not a fifth chance. We are already having our second chance. Each and every day. And that's when I opened with prayer. You know, each new day that we wake up, it's a blessing, because we're not guaranteed that we will survive the next night. We're given life is short and life is delicate, as Pastor Allen has explained the other night. We don't know when our time is up, except that as we progress, we have to have faith that God will allow us to reach our goal. But we live in a world of free choice, and someone else's free choice might cost us our own. But the doctrine that is so largely taught, that the gospel of Christ has made the law of God of none effect, that by believing we are released from the necessity of being doers of the word. But this doctrine is of the Nicolaitans, which Christ so unsparingly condemned. I've said it and I'll say it again. To the church of Ephesus, he says, I know thy works and thy labor and thy patience, and how thou canst not bear them which are evil, and thou hast tried them which say they are apostles and are not, and hast found them liars, and hast borne and hast patience for my name's sake, and hast labored and hast not fainted. Nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee, because thou hast left, I guess this is further back. But again, we see the same thing, that the law is immutable and we must obey it. I see. Turning back to Balaam, what was the tactic that he used against Israel? Didn't he counsel Balak to proclaim an idolatrous feast to honor their idol gods? And then he would persuade the Israelites to attend, that they might be delighted with the music, and then the most beautiful Midianitish woman, or women rather, should entice the Israelites to transgress the law of God. Excuse me, and to corrupt themselves, and also influence them to offer sacrifice to idols. How far they fell so quickly. Isn't that sort of what the Council of World Churches did? I mean, what was the requirement?
The same
God. Of course, it's not an official membership, but it was because of this organization that we started. Even before that, we were compromising, or the church that professes to be Adventist did. To Thessalonica, or Thessalotyra, excuse me, what did they do? What was their problem, rather?
Thyatira?
Yes.
Jezebel, to preach and to teach and to deceive.
And that's right. To seduce my servants to commit fornication, to eat things sacrificed unto idols. It's a very similar occurrence as before, only it seems to be closer to home. Do you know we have Jesuits teaching in our seminaries? The great adversary now endeavored to gain by artifice what he had failed to secure by force. Persecution ceased, and instead were substituted the dangerous allurements of temporal prosperity and worldly honor. You know, Adventism has become much more honored in the world than she was, certainly than in Ellen White's day. Idolaters were led to receive a part of the Christian faith, while they rejected other essential truths. They professed to accept Jesus as the Son of God and to believe in his death and resurrection, but they had no conviction of sin and felt no need to believe in his death and resurrection. But they had no conviction of sin, so felt no need of repentance or a change of heart. With some concessions on their part, they propose that Christians should make concessions and that all might unite on the platform of belief in Christ. There's a reason why the daughters of the Whore of Revelation are so much like her. is because they were formed in much the same way. Satan uses the same tactics over and over again. But of course they followed after her, and therefore their daughters, not sisters. Sardis says, be watchful and pray. Be watchful and strengthen the things that remain there ready to die, for I have not found thy works perfect before God. Remember therefore that thou hast received and heard, and hold fast and repent, if therefore thou wilt not watch. For I will come unto thee as a thief, and thou shalt not know what hour I come upon thee. And so things became undone, incomplete. Has anyone read the Council of Trent, what occurred there? The Protestant Church was this close from reforming the Catholic Church, but there was only one thing that hindered it, and that was the fact that the Catholic Church caught the Protestants in being inconsistent, because they claimed solus biblia, the Bible and the Bible alone, but yet they kept a tradition. Anyone know what that was?
Sunday.
That's right. Sunday worship. And it was at this point the Catholic Church declared Protestantism anathema. Excuse me. Laodicea, I know thy works, that thou art neither cold nor hot. I would that thou wert cold or hot. So then, because thou art lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will spew thee out of my mouth, because thou sayest, I am rich and increased with goods, and have need of nothing. And knowest thou not that thou art wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked? You know, all these things also apply on the individual level, and that's where the church really exists. It's a group of individuals, and each one is accountable. That's right, it's a body. And who should be the head but Christ? All of these conditions exist today. They are warnings to us. Do we love unrighteousness? Do we love idolatry? We may not think we do, but do we have idols? Maybe not of wood or stone, some perhaps, but not crafted to look like things in the earth. Have we contaminated ourselves by mingling with the ungodly in ungodly ways? We do need to reach out to them, but there are certain limits to how we are to reach out, that we don't want to encourage wickedness. 2 Corinthians chapter 13, if we'll turn there. Thank you. Second Corinthians chapter 13 and verse 5. It says, examine yourselves, whether ye be in the faith. Prove your own selves. Know ye not your own selves, how that Jesus Christ is in you, except ye be reprobates, Wherefore, let him that thinketh he standeth take heed, lest he fall. There hath no temptation taken you, but such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that ye are able, but will with the temptation also make a way to escape, that ye may be able to bear it. 1 Corinthians 10, 12, and 13. We need not follow after the same course as we've seen others throughout history and those surrounding us today. God has given us the opportunity to have victory over sin, and that victory lies in His Son Jesus through His Spirit. Continuing on in 1 Corinthians 10, verse 14, it says, "Wherefore, my dearly beloved, flee from idolatry." You remember in John, I think it was in the Epistle of John, and 1 John 5, I think, toward the end it says, "My little children, abstain from idolatry." I believe that's where it is. I'm going from my memory. Idolatry is a very key subject, because we can so easily be caught up in it, and yet we don't have idols of gold and silver that we kneel down to, but yet we can make an idol out of ideas, out of activities, out of food. Paul said, mentioned creating a god out of the belly. And what are we supposed to be doing today? What is our present truth?
Commandments of the Lord and the faith of Jesus.
That's right. Commandments of the Lord and the faith of Jesus. But I also think of Leviticus chapter 16. Leviticus 16, verse 29. It says, "And this shall be a statute for you forever unto you, that in the seventh month, on the tenth day of the month, ye shall afflict your souls and do no work at all, whether it be on your own country or a stranger that sojourneth among you." Verse 31, it says, "It shall be a Sabbath of rest unto you, and ye shall afflict your souls by a statute forever." Of course, forever means until it's complete. And we are living in the antitype of this. Today we are to afflict our souls. We are to look for sin in ourselves to see if it is there. We are to look to Christ for our example. We are to judge ourselves, but with righteous judgment. I will continue on and explain this a little bit in Luke chapter 15. And this is the parable of the prodigal son. Luke 15, starting in verse 25, it says, "And now his elder son was in the field. And as he came and drew nigh to the house, he heard music and dancing. And he called one of the servants and asked what these things meant. And he said unto him, Thy brother is come, and thy father hath killed the fatted calf, because he hath received him safe and sound. And he was angry, and would not go in. Therefore came his father out and entreated him. And he answered and said to his father, Lo, these many years do I serve thee, neither transgressed I at any time thy commandment. And yet thou never gavest me a kid that I might make merry with my friends. But as soon as this thy son was come, which hath devoured thy living with harlots, who hath killed for him the fatted calf. And he said unto him, Son, thou art ever with me, and all that is mine is thine. It was meet that we should make merry and be glad, for this thy brother was dead and is alive again, and was lost and is found." Who was in a worse condition? The elder son or the younger son? By this point, it becomes, I think, obvious. The older brother He watched not for his younger son, as did his father. He had not the anxiety for his well-being as his father did. He was cold and selfish and was not his brother's keeper. And in fact, he expected reward for his service. He was selfish in that regard. An individual, a family, a church, a nation cannot function when each individual neglects his common duty. Jesus has shown us a standard, what our duties are. Jesus said in John chapter 17, verse 15, I pray not that thou shouldst take them out of the world, but thou shouldst keep them from evil. They are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. Sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. As thou hast sent me into the world, even so have I sent them into the world. And for their sakes I sanctify myself, that they also might be sanctified through the truth. Jesus is our example. He is the living word of God. He is, as it were, the law incarnated, because the law is a transcript of God's character, and Jesus was a perfect representation. Now I see where that page I glanced over goes. But I think of all of the parables that Jesus taught, because Jesus was teaching a practical gospel. He was teaching, for instance, when you read about the parable of the 10 virgins, he was teaching practicality, that you apply what was taught into your life, that you go and practice it, that you develop a character that is perfect, a perfect representation of Christ. We are to not have pleasure in unrighteousness, but pleasure in the truth, as it is in Jesus. We don't have to go astray as these churches in the past have, but we have a way out. History does not have to repeat itself in that way. Israel was freed from Egypt, but yet it seemed like it was still somehow captive throughout that journey. And we have a journey to a Canaan that we must take. And we have a helper who is willing to help us. And we can help one another, because God can inspire each one of us to lend a helping hand, to lend a quiet voice, a gentle voice to each other. I'm sorry my sermon was kind of jumbled up, but I pray that you'll continue to be blessed at this camp meeting. And I thank you for your time.